thought it was stuck. But I guess she thought I was stuck. Good morning. It's so nice to see y'all today. I see we have a pink theme going back there. Charlie, you look great in pink. Oh, I don't think you can hear me. We're good. Anyway, glad to see you. Glad you're here. Wanted to let you know that I'm excited for something special today. All of these lovely people wearing white, they're not here to literally serve us food or drink. They're here to serve us something else. So that will be wonderful to experience. Wednesday? Is that July 4th? No? Thursday. I was going to close the church office on Wednesday, too. What do y'all think about that? Betty Faye, does it work for you? She says yes. So I guess we'll be here Wednesday, but we won't be here Thursday. So if you come, we won't be here. Other than that, I don't believe I have any announcements. Does anyone have any they'd like to share? Ah, darn. There's a really big thing tonight at church. It's the talent show. It's really big. So if you're going to participate in the talent show, please be here at 4:30 so you can be mic'd up and run through whatever talent it is that you will be sharing. And then 5:30 you may arrive to get your seat because I'm sure it's going to be standing room only. And at 6 o'clock the show will begin. Somewhere between 5:30 and 6 you're going to get to have hot dogs. Right, Miriam? She says yes. Hot dogs and chili? Uh-huh. We going to have drink too? Tea? Uh-huh. All right. We know how to eat in this place. Oh, ice cream sandwiches. I'll take two. Yes, I want three. My pants have an elastic waist. Okay, it's time to be doing church now, y'all. What did you say? Oh, Maddox would like y'all to know that I'd take 80 ice cream sandwiches. He's in training up there with Milton today. All right, y'all, time to do some church. So if you are able, please stand and we will sing our first hymn.
Thank you.
follow along with me for our responsive reading. It'll be on the screen as well as in your bulletin. For freedom, Christ has set us free.
Let us stand firm, for we are called to freedom.
Sisters and brothers, let us not use our freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence.
Through love, we will be servants of one another.
Having been set free, we will live by the Spirit. Living and guided by the Spirit, we are inheritors of the kingdom of God.
Together we will strive to make God's freedom known on earth as it is in heaven. Amen.
You may be seated. Our scripture reading today is from Galatians chapter 5, verse 1, and then 13 through 25. For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. For you were called to freedom, brothers and sisters, only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence. But through love become slaves to one another. For the whole law is summed up in a single commandment, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. If, however, you bite and devour one another, take care that you are not consumed by one another. Live by the Spirit, I say, and do not gratify the desires of the flesh, for what the flesh desires is opposed to the Spirit. And what the Spirit desires is opposed to the flesh, for these are opposed to each other, to prevent you from doing what you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not subject to the law. Now the works of the flesh are obvious: fornication, impurity, licentiousness, idolatry, sorcery, enmities, strife, jealousy, anger, quarrels, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and things like these. I am warning you, as I warned you before, those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. By contrast, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against such things, and those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also be guided by the Spirit. The word of God for the people of God. Now's the time when we get to share our joys and concerns with one another. I have two that I'd like to share with you all. One is that there was a celebration of life service for Miriam's sister yesterday, and both Miriam and Alan participated in the ceremony, so that's something to be grateful for. Miriam told me that her sister loved her from the day she was born. I love that. Who doesn't? The second thing is that I ask you to please keep Kaylee Jackson in your prayers. Her father, Rusty, passed away from a heart attack on Friday, and they're getting ready to go through quite a difficult time in his absence, her half-brothers as well as she. So please keep that family in your prayers and lift them up. Are there any others? Ms. Joyce.
This is a concern about the man that was in missing in action, and they brought his body back to New Bern. Mr. Stephen Nance, and his wake will be Monday evening from 6 to 8, and he happened to be my ex-daughter-in-law's of Ken. So we are going over to the wake on Monday night at Cotton's Funeral Home. But we did see on the Facebook about the Avenue of Flags. So he will be carried away very good, and he will be buried into the National Cemetery on National Avenue in New Bern. Okay, thank you.
I'd like to thank the congregation for all the care and concerns and prayers, and also the cards have been a real blessing too. I didn't do it. The cards have been a real blessing to me, and I want to thank you all.
Anyone else? So Jacob whispered that because I don't think he wants to really put it out there in the world, but he will be driving for 10 hours with 3 children in a vehicle, so he is asking for patience and safety. And he really whispered it. All right, will you go with me to prayer? Dear Lord, help us to find our joy in you. You are the source of all good things, and a life that draws its strength from you is a life of true and deep joy. Even in the tough times, help us to rejoice in your goodness and your plan for our lives. Let us remember that there is no reason to worry or be anxious, for you have a plan much greater than anything we could ever understand. May we find peace in your steadiness, your faithfulness, your strength, and your desire not to harm. Lord, help us to practice patience and learn to wait for your timing and your plan instead of rushing forward with our own. As we remember that one act of kindness in your name may not change the world, we know that it could change a life. May we give to others expecting nothing in return, the way you give blessings upon blessings every day. In all things, in all times, even when we don't understand, God, you are good. May our thoughts be good, wholesome, and righteous. Lead us in the way to do the right thing so that we can show others your way through our faithfulness and a pure heart. As we put all our trust in you, may we faithfully give you control of every matter in our lives. May we focus on your will for our life and follow you even when the call for us may be the things we don't understand. And as we give generously of our time and our talents. Lord, may we show our strength through our meekness. If we are to raise our voices, may it be only to raise them in prayer and praise to you. And may our gentleness turn away anger. We know that if we give in, our feet will fail us and we will stumble. If that happens, convict our spirits to not continue in their temptations and practice self-control. Help us to stand up strong and lean on you to continue in the way set before us. Lord, we thank you. Thank you for the example that you have given us in your Son, Jesus Christ. Be alongside us as we work day by day to be your hands and feet here on earth, to show the love you so freely give us. And may the fruits of your spirit inspire our spirits to bear fruit for you. We ask all these things as we pray the prayer given to us, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
Thank you. Let us pray. Most good and gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this wonderful day, and we just thank you for letting us live in a place like this, and let us worship in a place as good as we've got it. As we lead into next week, let us remember the many, many women and men that gave their lives for our freedom, and let us not forget that. But at this moment, we thank you, God, for the sacrifices you made of giving your Son for us to give up of our many, many sins. We thank you for that, God, and we thank you for everything. Amen.
On that night in the upper room with his disciples, Jesus took a loaf of bread, and after he'd given thanks, he broke it. He said, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also, and he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you partake of it in remembrance of me." The love of Christ, the blood of the new covenant. The gifts of God for each and every one of us, the children of God. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, all we have and all we will ever have comes from you. Help us develop a spirit of generosity and sharing with others so that all may know of your goodness through us. Amen.
Thank you so much for today and all your many blessings, especially these very generous gifts today. Please use them to your will. In your precious name.
Amen.
Thank you.
What a special day already this has been. I was thinking a few moments ago, I don't know if you noticed the way Jillian invited us to join her in prayer. She said, let's go to prayer. Did you notice that? Did anybody happen to notice that? And I was thinking about it. When we go to prayer, we recognize that prayer takes us to another place. It takes us actually to a higher form of reality. And as I was listening to that prayer, I was just awed, really, that with your ability and just what a gift you are. And honestly, I was taken to another place. And to hear the voice of a child and the prayers of the elders and our wonderful choir and just that wonderful piece of music we just heard on the piano just lifts our spirits. I pray that not one of us would take for granted how fortunate we are to be in this place at this time. This morning, we are reflecting together on freedom, and that's been the theme throughout, from our scripture reading to some of the songs that we've heard, and even the prayer at the communion table. And while this passage that we're going to read in just a few seconds doesn't seem directly about freedom, it is really has a lot to do with freedom. It is the freedom of Jesus, who had the knowledge of God's will, the power to fulfill God's will, and the willingness to carry it through. And we're going to hear that he set his face toward Jerusalem, and he knew what was waiting on him there. So in the context of freedom, and Jesus' freedom, he was free like you and me to take that path or not. Let's turn our attention to the gospel according to St. Luke chapter 9, verses 51 through 58. When the days drew near for him to be taken up, he set his face to go to Jerusalem. And he sent messengers ahead of him. On their way, they entered a village of the Samaritans to make ready for him, but they did not receive him because his face was set toward Jerusalem. When his disciples James and John saw it, they said, Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them? But he turned and rebuked them. Then they went on to another village. As they were going along the road, someone said, I will follow you wherever you go. And Jesus said to him, foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. May our lives be transformed by the reading and hearing of these words. Amen. It's an important week coming up this week. I've had a number of people this morning ask me if I had 4th of July plans. I love this. I love being in a family of faith. I had one who is like a mother to me send me home to get red, white, and blue because I didn't have any in my office, and I was really grateful for that. It had slipped my mind, so I'm grateful to have people, and in a community of faith like this, I have a number of you who mother me in wonderful ways, and I'm going to visit my mother this week, and so she will be glad that I am in good hands, and I really am grateful to be a part of this community. This week means something different to a lot of us, but for many of us, I think there's a common theme. You'll hear a theme next week, but this week, I want to focus on freedom. As Americans, I know that freedom is among the values that we hold the most dear. The founding fathers and founders of a vision of this country, I really do believe, were inspired. They had a vision of freedom, equality, and justice. Those are eternal values. It is a vision that we have struggled to live into, and it's a vision that's worth us struggling to live into. And it's important for us as people of faith generally, and as Christians in particular, to reflect on what freedom means from a Christian perspective. Because I believe that Jesus was the freest person to ever live. And when he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, his way is the way to freedom. His truth is the truth of freedom, and his life is a life of freedom. And so we want to pay particular attention to Jesus and how he understood freedom. I have reflected for some time on the notion of freedom, that reality of freedom. Throughout my formal education years, that was one of the most pressing concerns I had. What does it mean to be free? And for many theologians, they believe that salvation, in a number of ways, can be equated with freedom. They take freedom that seriously. When we look at the Hebrew scriptures, when we look at the Israelites who were in bondage to an Egyptian pharaoh, and their plight was one of oppression and slavery, we know throughout the biblical witness that God is the God of liberation. God is the God of freedom, political, social, personal freedom. We know that the Hebrew people, the Israelites, were led out into the wilderness. They were set free from Egyptian bondage, and yet they were still not free. They were not free, whether it was the capacity or the willingness, they were still not free to obey, to fulfill the law, the will of God. They did not have the capacity or the will to trust God. And so I've been thinking about a way for us to understand what does freedom mean from a faithful perspective. And this is not a definition I read somewhere, but I think there are three components of freedom, at least three, maybe there are more, but I believe that these are necessary. Number one, I believe we have to have the knowledge of God's will. We need to actually know what God's will is so that we can be free. We have to have the capacity, the ability to fulfill God's will. And then thirdly, we have to have the willingness to fulfill God's will. When we know God's will, when we have the capacity to do God's will, and when we are willing to fulfill God's will, I believe that is freedom from a faithful perspective, properly understood. Now, for many of us, it could be the case that we have the knowledge of God's will, and we may feel like we're willing to do God's will, but we don't have the capacity, we don't have the ability. For others, we feel like we have the capacity, or others have the capacity, they know God's will, they have the capacity, but not the willingness. And those are difficult circumstances to be in, but my concern is that there's a third that could be even more dangerous. And that is the assumption that we know God's will. And having made that assumption, recognizing that we have a power that is available to us, and if we are willing. So if there is the power and the willingness to follow a false assumption about God's will, that can actually be very, very dangerous. That can be dangerous for us as persons. That can be dangerous for our families. That can be dangerous within our churches. That can be dangerous for us or any nation. And as we look throughout history, we recognize that there have been nations. There have been nations that had immense power at their disposal, extraordinary military power. And there have been times when they thought they knew God's will, and they were willing to use that power. And we know that there have been occasions in history when people in God's name have committed atrocities. Even nations have done so. And so as a nation and as a people and as people who are disciples, followers of Jesus, we want to be careful about what we understand to be freedom, what we know to be freedom, the knowledge of God's will, the capacity to fill it, and the willingness to fulfill it. So let's think for a few moments about freedom. What have we been set free from a Christian perspective? We have been set free from sin. Sin is part of the human condition, and it is much more multifaceted than I think people sometimes recognize. There are those who focus primarily, sometimes exclusively, on what I would refer to as personal sin. There are others who focus primarily, almost exclusively, on social sin. So let's talk about that for a moment. There is something about the human condition. There is a gone wrongness, as you've heard me say, and that's not my own. That was a theologian's way of describing the human condition. All of us can agree that within our own personal lives, there is a gone wrongness. There are times that we want to act in such a way, and we don't act in that way. There are some times that we would wish that we could stop acting in such a way, and we keep on acting that way. Those are the words of Paul himself, and as much of an apostle and as much as his life had been transformed, he continued to struggle with sin, and each one of us can understand that. Paul gave us a list of sins that are the result of the human condition, of being led by the flesh, as he calls it, and that's what he's referring to, the human condition. But when we are set free, we begin to be set free from that human condition. When we begin to recognize who Jesus is as the Son of God, the Son of God who reveals who we are as sons and daughters of God. And I repeat that often because I want us to begin to internalize that. For many of us, we confess that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and we proclaim him as Savior. But if we're not careful, we can make that statement without really thinking about what that means. For some of us, we think it's kind of a formula, that if we will make this confession, then we are saved. It's important, I believe, for us to know something about the confession that we've made. Jesus is the Son of God. What does that mean? Jesus is the Son of God. Well, we are created in God's image. You and I are created in God's image. God looked at all that God created and said, "It is good." It is very, very good. We are created in God's image. Our essential nature is that we are good. Our condition does not always align with our nature. And so when we look at Jesus, we are set free because he is the Son of God. We are children of God. We, like Jesus, are children of God. So he reveals who we are. He reveals who we are created to be. And then that process is beginning. That process has begun. And we are set free even as we are being set free. Some theologians refer to it as the already not yet. The already not yet. We are already set free, but we are not yet fully free. And so we are in the process of becoming free. Now, when we begin this process, and for those of us who realize that this power is beyond us. The power is the power of grace. The power is the power of the Holy Spirit. If we are led by the Spirit, if we are guided by the Spirit. For some of us, and I say this particularly in this context on a regular basis, many of you grew up in church from the time you were born. Your parents had you in church. For some of you, you've been in this church your whole lives, and you were fortunate to have people who were instructive in your lives, and perhaps you don't know the magnitude of some of the personal sins that those of us who were not so fortunate to be in a faith family, or if we had some other groups beyond our immediate. I was fortunate to have a wonderful mother, but like most adolescents, my group beyond my immediate family didn't always recognize what it means to be guided by the Spirit. And I can remember, it was interesting, before I had the language to understand it, then all of a sudden I developed the language. Many of you are familiar with the language of love, the language of the Spirit, love, eros, philia, and agape. And it was interesting because I didn't fully understand this love, this agape love, until I had encountered it. But this is what's interesting, and I want us to recognize this. For many who navigate this life apart from a faith, they are bound to the first two kinds of love. Their relationships are rooted in eros, which can be similar desires, similar pleasures, people who enjoy the same things, similar habits. And philia, by and large, is a reciprocal kind of love. There's a mutual benefit from being in those relationships. And there are a number of people, unfortunately, that their existence and their relationships are, for the most part, characterized in that way. And in some ways, they're still in bondage, personal bondage, because that list of sins that we saw, oftentimes it is a form of self-seeking. Don't use your freedom for self-indulgence. And so even relationships that people encounter are not for the other's sake. They're primarily rooted in what the person can get out of it. And so we are liberated from personal sin. And wherever there is personal sin, there is always social sin. There is always communal sin, because the truth is, we really are interrelated. We are not an island unto ourselves. We are interconnected. We are one body with many parts. And I love that the church emphasizes that, but that's true of all of humanity. What affects one directly affects all indirectly. That's not just a platitude. That's not a clever statement. We were created for one another. So if there is a sin in my life, that prevents me from being able to fully reach my potential. And if I can't fully reach my potential, then I can't fully make the contribution I'm called to make. And so we want to see the nature of social sin. We want to see the nature of social sin because sometimes, if we're not careful, we're complicit in social sin. It's important for us to continue to grow in our understanding of sin and how it affects our lives and other people's lives. And sometimes we don't like talking about these things. And I tell you, I truly do struggle with this, from the clothes that we wear, from the coffee that we drink, to the seemingly harmless day-to-day decisions we make. We are literally connected to people all over this globe. Did you know that? The things that we consume, the things that we purchase, those things affect people on the other side of the planet. And so we want to be continually set free from our personal and our social sins. Well, what is sin? Sin, most fundamentally, is to miss the mark. What mark? The mark of God's will. And so we want to continue to be set free both personally and socially. What are we free for? That's just as important. For some people, there is a focus on no longer being sinful or overcoming or transcending some of their personal and social sins. But what are we free for? Well, Paul has said to us again what we've heard Jesus say, that the whole law is summed up in a single commandment: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Now, we've heard a lot about this, and we hear about it in different ways, but this is the radicality of that statement. This is actually a very radical statement. We are set free to see ourselves and other people the way God sees us. Now, that too seems like a simple statement, but it has far-reaching and very profound implications. Most societies, Greek society, at that time part of the Hebrew society, we know that in our current society, beyond these church walls, and occasionally even within the church walls, there is a status system. There is a hierarchy. There is a rank. But to love one another as we love ourselves makes us all truly equal. Now, again, our founders were wise enough to say that we should live into the vision of freedom, equality, and justice. To recognize that we are called to love our neighbors as ourselves is to recognize that we are genuinely equal in the eyes of God. We are truly all children of God. And there is no higher status There's no higher status for a human being. Sometimes because we've been so conditioned in society, we've been so conditioned historically, and unfortunately, somehow it made its way into the church. We've been conditioned in the church for me to say that we are all equal in our minds. If we're not careful, that means that we're bringing those at the top down. That's where our minds go. But that's not true. To say that we are equal is to elevate everyone to their proper status, the highest status there is. We are all children of God, and that's the reason you hear me cite the passage in Philippians where Paul, in a moment of extraordinary illumination and inspiration, says, "Have in you the mind of Christ, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, to be grasped at, to be clung to, but he emptied himself and took the form of a slave." He took the lowest possible status on earth. What happens when God takes the lowest possible status? That status takes on divine status. We need to begin to see each other as God sees us, as the equal children of God with infinite dignity and worth. And then we are set free for the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God. There are a number of ways of understanding how we personally are to be governed, how we personally are to be ruled, what rules our lives, what governs our personal lives. There are different ways that we understand that a society should be ruled or governed. There are different ways of understanding that a church should be ruled and governed. And these words sound like some of those difficult words, but I'm using them because I think they can shed some light on what we're trying to consider here. One of the ways of being ruled is heteronomy. Heteronomy, what does that mean? It means to be ruled from the outside. It can be as extreme as a military dominance, an outside foreign power that is imposing a rule. There's another one that I think is more subtle that we have to be careful of, and sometimes it can be the rule of a society, the rule of a culture, and that can be an American culture, it can be a church culture, it can be a religious tradition, it can be a denomination, but it's one in which there are rules and it is clear and there's a relative degree of pressure. We want to be a part of that group, and if we were to transcend or violate those rules, then we might be ostracized or there may be consequences, and so heteronomy, we go along with what the rules are. And for some of us, it can be a matter of our faith, that we have inherited a certain kind of faith, and that's the general expectation of what a faithful person should be. This is how a faithful person acts. A faithful person does these things and doesn't do those things, and we inherit that, and it can be a rule from the outside, a religious tradition. For some, they say that a level of progression can be autonomy. We know what that word is. It's self-rule, autonomy, where we get to the place where we've grown in our wisdom and we know right from wrong and we do not need a heteronomy. We do not need a culture or a group to tell us what is right or wrong. There's another form of autonomy, and that's the one that Paul was talking about when he called it licentiousness. I trip over that word every time. I invite you to say it three times back to back. Licentiousness. What is licentiousness? It comes from that word license. It means freedom, essentially to do whatever you feel like or what you want to do. Ultimate freedom. And it's interesting now that Paul contrasts licentiousness, the freedom to do what you want, with standing firm in the freedom that Christ has set us free, the calling to be free. And it's interesting that he even words it that, speaking of what we want. Live by the Spirit, I say, and do not gratify the desires of the flesh, verse 16 and verse 17. For what the flesh desires is opposed to the Spirit, and what the Spirit desires is opposed to the flesh. For these are opposed to one another to prevent you from doing what you want. Now that's an interesting statement, isn't it? And he goes on to say, if you commit these particulars, if you practice these things, I am warning you, he says in verse 21, as I warned you before, those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. What are we to make of this? We are saved by grace through faith and not by works, so that none would boast. We are saved by grace through faith. Paul is concerned to reiterate to the Galatians over and over and over, "You foolish Galatians," he says, "you are saved by grace, not the works of the law. And yet, if we do these things, we will not inherit the kingdom of God." This is what I believe we need to recognize. The kingdom of God, like our liberation, is an already, not yet. It is already present. It has not yet been fulfilled. The kingdom of God within us is already present, but not yet fulfilled. See, what we want to do is to have a theonomy. We want to be God-ruled, kingdom-ruled, where love really is operative in every area of our lives, and we realize those things we thought we wanted are not what we actually want. Jesus really is the way, the truth, and the life. The Spirit really does lead to love, joy, kindness, generosity, patience, self-control, all that is life-giving. We want to be God-ruled. And sometimes, when we are God-ruled, we will be called and be called to a kind of freedom that can be quite challenging. Jesus set his face toward Jerusalem. Jesus is the freest person this world has ever known because he had the knowledge, he had the power, and he had the willingness to be God-ruled, kingdom-ruled, love-ruled, no matter what. Now, it's interesting that in Luke, he points out that he sent some people ahead to Samaria. And because he had his face set toward Jerusalem, they did not receive him. Do you know what that was about? It was about over the proper place to worship. Can you imagine not being able to receive Jesus because some people thought it's better to worship in this place, and some people thought it was better to worship in that place. Some people thought it was better to worship on this mountain. Some people thought it was better to worship in that city. Some people thought it was better to worship in a formal environment. Some people thought it was better to worship in a casual environment. Can you imagine missing Jesus because of a tradition that was more important than the one that a tradition should have pointed toward? There's another aspect of it, though. And this is the one that's more difficult for us. To be kingdom-ruled is to be love-ruled. And sometimes love can be very costly. I believe this. Jesus was a Jew, that I know. And he loved the Jews enough to challenge them when they were outside of God's will. Now, this may seem like a strange statement, too. Even though Rome was an outside oppressive force that humiliated the Hebrew people, I believe that Jesus was free enough to love them too. And his resistance itself was a form of love. Sometimes the greatest form of love we have is to resist our religious tradition when it's outside the will of God. Sometimes it's the greatest form of patriotism to challenge our country when our country is moving in a direction that is outside the will of God. To do that, it takes discernment over time. It takes maturity over time. It takes discipline and prayer and cultivating Christian maturity, as Paul often described it. And once having developed it, it requires that we stand firm, that we resist anything that would prevent us from enjoying the freedom that God truly desires for us personally, that we would stand firm and resist anything that would prevent others from enjoying their God-given freedom. So this Sunday, as we look forward to a week where we celebrate our freedom, my prayer for us is that we will do so with a renewed sense of what it means to be free, to be set free from personal and social sin, to be free for the kingdom of God. May we stand firm. Amen. If there's anyone here this morning who has never made a confession of faith, we're making a confession of faith in the one who sets us free. And making that confession of faith is the most important step we'll ever take on the path of freedom. If there's anyone here this morning that is seeking a community of faith, we are together being set free. We are free and we're being set free, and we assist one another in that process. And then each of us has the opportunity to renew our dedication to being people of freedom from a Christ-like perspective. I invite you to stand as you're able as we sing our hymn of commitment.